October 15th, 2012. The record should show that we have four commissioners present tonight, and the first thing on our agenda is to look at our order of business, our agenda. Mr. Kessel, I understand we have a couple of changes to make on that agenda.
We do, Vice President Jackson. If we could move agenda item 4D1 down to 6C2, I would appreciate that. And then if we could postpone item number 4B until a, excuse me, 6B until a future commission meeting, I would appreciate that. There's a little bit of work we have yet to do on that item itself.
Okay. Any commissioners have any other changes to the agenda, the order of business?
I make a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 That motion carries. Okay, you have the consent agenda before you. Anybody have any questions on any of the six items on the consent agenda? If not, can we have a motion to approve?
So move.
Second.
Okay, we will vote. Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
Mr. Altman?
Aye.
Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. We will move to, we have three timetable agenda items that don't start until 5 o'clock, so we will move to the non-timetable agenda, item 4 on your agenda. And the first item there is our financial report. Mrs. Johnson?
Mr. Vice President, Commissioners, I'd like to highlight a few items from the financial report through September. We'll begin with the general fund report. With 75% of the year completed, our property taxes equal $3.2 million and were 98% collected compared to budget. Our other taxes and fees, which includes financial institution tax and franchise fees, is 96% collected compared to budget. Our intergovernmentals, which include highway distribution tax and oil production tax, is 77% collected compared to budget. Our licenses, fees, and services, which include things such as building permit revenue and oil royalties, is 93% collected compared to budget. Our building permit revenue is up $443,000 over last year. This category also includes municipal court fines, which are up $149,000 over last year. In our sale of city lots and equipment, we have sold over a million dollars worth of city lots through September. And our total general fund revenues equal $8.9 million and were 79% collected through September. Our general fund expenses are broken down into groups. Our general government, which includes administration, court, finance, and buildings and grounds, is 89% expended compared to budget. Our public safety, which includes police and fire, is 74% expended compared to budget. And our engineering and streets is also 74% expended compared to budget. Our cultural services, which includes museum and forestry, is 55% expended compared to budget. And our total general fund expenses equal $8.3 million through September and were 72% expended compared to budget. In our enterprise funds, our water and wastewater revenues total $7.8 million through September and were 121% collected compared to budget and 56% more than last year. The increase is due mostly to bulk water sales. Our expenses and capital outlays total $7.6 million, which is 142% expended compared to budget. This increase is due to construction of the wastewater treatment plant, which will move to the building construction fund at year end. Our solid waste fund revenue is $2.5 million through September, which is 90% collected compared to budget and 22% more than last year. And our expenses and capital outlays total $2 million, which is 73% expended compared to budget. In our sales tax reports, in our 1% sales tax fund, we received $486,000 of revenue in September, which is up 46% for the year. Our 1% sales tax fund is broken down into groups. The first is our 50% share, which transfers 50% of our total revenue received to the Street Projects Fund. This transfer occurs at year end. The transfer in 2012 is budgeted to be $2.6 million. The second is the 20% share, which is for job creation and senior programs. This segment funds Stark Development, Elder Care, and RSVP subsidies, along with the Senior Citizen and Southwest Regional Grant programs. And the third segment is our 30% share, which is set aside for capital improvements. The expenses here include part of the BAC pledge payment. In our half percent sales tax, we received $243,000 of revenue in September, which is also up 46% for the year. Our expenses include payment for the West River Community Center bond. In our hospitality tax, we received $73,000 of revenue in September, which is up 37% over last year. Our expenses include $1 million for the BAC pledge payment and $155,000 for the airport and parks and rec subsidies. In our occupancy tax, we received $52,000 of revenue in September, which is up 64% over last year. And our expenses include $246,000 paid to the CVB for their subsidy and $60,000 for the special events grant. Our street projects report, we received $89,000 in revenue, and we've expended $1.4 million towards those projects through September. And our development impact fee program shows that this program has a balance of $386,000 available for commitment at the end of September. Those are some of the highlights from the financial statements through September. I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mrs. Jensen. Any commissioners have any questions or comments on the financial report? I would ask only one, Mrs. Johnson. You showed the balance on the impact fee program. We're going to look at approving final assessments on six projects tonight. The number you showed is net of all these projects, correct? All these?
Well, as money comes in to pay those specials, then the balance will increase.
But as
that's
far,
available.
As far as the expenses go?
Yes, they would include that's, all those, correct.
Okay. Anything else? We should have a motion to approve the financial report.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion on that motion? If not, we'll vote. Mr. Oltmans?
Aye.
Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Motion carries. Okay, item 4B is a development agreement for the S&B subdivision. Mr. Kohling, are you going to take that?
I am.
Okay.
And Mr. Jackson, commissioners, in your packet is a proposed development agreement for S&B Dickinson Apartments 1. The property affected by this development agreement is located generally on the southwest corner of the intersection of State Avenue North and 21st Street. The development agreement is consistent with similar development agreements that the city has required from other developers. It does also provide for certain off-site improvements to be constructed along 19th Street and 21st, as well as State Avenue North. And when those developments occur, we will enter into some other negotiations with the developer to come to an appropriate cost share agreement for the city's portion of those developments as well. The development agreement also provides for the city to receive a security or a bond from the developer to assure the completion of the infrastructure that they would be required to complete under this agreement. Mr. Jackson.
Okay. Anybody have questions on that agreement? Any questions or comments on the agreement? If not, we need a motion to approve.
So move.
Mr. Steiner, do we have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on the S&B development agreement? If not, we'll vote. Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Oltmans?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. That motion is approved. Okay, next agenda item is a proclamation having to do with the Mayor's Committee celebrating diversity and disability awareness. I should ask if there's anybody here from the Mayor's Committee. I don't see anybody. If not, Mr. Kessel, do you want to read through the proclamation, and we'll see if anybody up here opposes it?
I'll certainly show off my good North Dakota education. Whereas the Dickinson's Mayor's Committee on the Employment of Persons with Disabilities has organized a celebration of diversity and disability awareness in recognition that persons with disabilities are an important part of the community of Dickinson, and whereas the committee has organized Diversity Day activities which shall take place the week of October 21st through October 27th, 2012, in conjunction with the Dickinson Public and Parochial School System to create an awareness of and appreciation of persons with differences, and whereas the committee, composed of volunteers from many organizations from Dickinson who give many hours to awareness of diversity and disability awareness, has established this month of October as their celebration of diversity and disability awareness, and now therefore, as the City of Dickinson Commission President Dennis Johnson hereby proclaim the week of October 21st, 2012 to October 27th, 2012 as Diversity Days Week, and the month of October as Celebration of Diversity and Disability Awareness Month in the City of Dickinson, North Dakota.
Thank you, Mr. Kessel. Certainly a worthy cause, and we're very happy to be part of enhancing the awareness that the Mayor's Committee achieves to achieve on this topic. I expect nobody has any issue with the proclamation, and when the mayor returns, we'll get him to sign it and be on our way. Okay. That takes us to reports from our city commissioner, our city administrator, Mr. Kessel.
Thank you, Vice President. I have one report this evening. It's a safety report. It's the third quarter safety report for 2012. I just want to mention a few things to highlight that report. You should have a copy in front of you. As of September 30th, we've recorded 47 incidences of employee injuries, with 12 of those incidences occurring in the third quarter. Unfortunately, this does represent a 75% increase of the year-end total for 2010 and a 35% increase over last year's total. The year-end summaries for 2011 and 2010 have been provided for your review and comparison. With the percentage increases we are experiencing, the potential of severe injury occurring increases as well. Departmental safety meetings, specific training, and enforcement of safety policies in all departments will help to limit additional incidents. Six of the 12 third quarter incidences required medical attention. There were no lost time injuries, however, an accommodation was made for all the employees with some work restrictions. Obviously, that kind of injury is something that we're trying to avoid at all costs. Our employees are way too important to get injured on the job, so we make every effort to make their jobs safe through training and or equipment. We do review each and every incident report at the leadership team meetings, and so we have a chance and an opportunity to discuss that as a group so that one department can learn from another in terms of accidents and injuries. So I would like to mention that Chief Sivak is our safety coordinator, and he and the rest of the fire department does a really nice job in making sure that they're on top of safety incidences within the city. So with that would conclude my report on safety, unless there's questions from the commission.
Mr. Vice Chair, Mr. Kessel, the majority of those incidences are at the Baylor Building?
Not necessarily at the Baylor Building. We do get certainly some there. I would say that solid waste is overly represented in our accidents and injuries. We have had this year several explosions, small ones, related to some of the trash that has been collected and has been baled, which has sent some of our staff to the hospital, unfortunately. And we've tried to take safety precautions against that. But yes, the solid waste department is overrepresented.
I think it's important to mention that when you talk about explosions at the Baylor Building and so on, because a lot of people are trying to wrap around why we're inspecting their loads that are taken out there, they're covered, and why we're going through and making sure that there's nothing put in there that can cause this type of injury to our employees. So with that in mind, I mean, that is probably, I mean, pollutants, explosives, and so on to keep our employees safe. So that is one big reason why we're doing it.
Has it helped since they're separating the debris? The contractors are sorting the, has it helped, or is it, doesn't make any difference with the accidents?
Well, we certainly have to remain diligent, because the types of explosions are generally from batteries that are located in the trash, and then they, for whatever reason, heat up and blow up. But separation is something that we highly encourage. Another reason for the injuries is on our rear loader. Those are manually loaded in the back of the trucks, and those also tend to be lifting and twisting injuries. So those are commonplace with that truck specifically. So, but to get to your question, yes.
I was concerned separation. About nails and different things.
Yes. Okay.
Mr. Steiner raises a good point. The question I had, we've got this percentage increase. I know we have increased staff numbers also, but I suspect that that percentage increase is greater than what we've increased staff.
That would be accurate, yes.
It's not a proportionate.
No, we're experiencing more injuries, even though we have added staff. There proportionately are more injuries than there are increase in staff.
Okay, anything else on the safety management? Mr. Kessel?
No, that would conclude my report on there. I do have one other item, if you would indulge me for a few seconds.
Sure.
As we all know, tonight is Engineer Soren's last night as a full-time employee with the City of Dickinson. We're all sorry and sad to see him leave. I've attempted many times to get him to change his mind, and he still tells me he's going to leave. So I do certainly wish him well. We're looking forward to continuing working with Mr. Soren. He is staying in Dickinson. We are very, very close to an agreement to have him continue with some project work for the city. But it would be, as I review replacing his position, and we've had probably three different discussions already about what the best manner is to do that. And it certainly becomes more and more clear that with the growth that we have today, that maybe going back to a model that we experienced in Dickinson not that long ago, probably about 4 years ago, if you remember right, we basically had two public works coordinators, if you want to call it that. And we changed that model about 3 or so years ago when city engineer at the time, Soren, agreed to take on the role and responsibilities of public works director. At those times, they were much quieter, a lot less things to do than there are today. And you'll receive the code enforcement report later this evening just to emphasize that point of how much is more is going on. So understanding the environment that we are in today, I really believe that we should look at separating those two jobs again and look hard at hiring a public works director who would be in charge of the administrative departments of street, water, solid waste and storm, and then hire a city engineer as well who could take on the engineering department and continue to be a projects manager for within the city of Dickinson. Now, I can put some numbers together for you that certainly would be at a higher expense, and it's an unbudgeted expense at this time. But if the commission is so inclined, I'll do some more research, present that to you if it's something you'd like to pursue.
What about APEC? Who's going to work with them now?
Commissioner Dukart, I'm glad you asked, because we did have a meeting. We sat down with Mr. Soren and all the other direct reports for him and talked about that transition. One of the things in the interim that we did talk about is using a consulting firm such as APEC, or other firms have also stepped up to the plate and offered their services. So it'd be a matter of determining which is the best fit and which projects they would work best with.
I know they're really going strong out there now, so we don't want to hold anything up.
Well, the nice thing about APEC is they only do work for government, and so the perception of conflict of interest, which you may get in a private firm that does private business, could exist, and that's removed with APEC.
Well, I think that the notion that we simply need to spread those responsibilities around is is an appropriate one. There's probably a couple, three different ways to do that, but I think it's something that should be pursued. I don't know if the rest of you have any thoughts in that regard.
Well, I would say definitely pursue it. You know, we historically had two people overseeing those duties, and Sean took all those duties on and admirably and did a phenomenal job, but it's overwhelming in the environment that we are, and I think we would have a hard time showing those as the duties of the engineer and have somebody really excited about the position too. I think dividing those back out, especially where we're at now, would make the most sense.
I agree. That's one of the comments he made, was that he didn't give them more than 2 hours a week. That's not, as a director, I don't think that's enough.
Okay, anything else, Mr. Kessel?
No, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Mr. Vice Chair, just one question for Mr. Sorin. When is your last day?
That is today.
That is today. Okay. Have you done the exit interview?
I've sat down with Mrs. Nominuk, and we've talked about some things. Sean and I will talk some more. As he said, we're working on an agreement to try and work together, so we'll keep those communications open.
But what I'm getting at is I'm looking forward to seeing your exit interview, as into what you would recommend. I mean, now's the opportunity for you
right
to let us know where we did not come to terms, or, you know, need to step up somewhere. And
well, I think part of the recommendations that Mr. Kessel's made tonight has certainly been things that we've talked about. You know, as I've indicated to him, I'm not 100% convinced that it's far enough, but we will have those discussions and move forward, and we got to start somewhere.
Thank you.
Okay. We'll move to public safety and hear from the fire department. Mrs. Barros.
Good evening, Vice President.
Good evening.
Commissioners. It will be a very short monthly report for the month of September. Okay, here's our incident responses for the last 3 years. As you can see, we had 12 incidents in 2010 that we responded to for the month of September. We had 22 for 2011. And for 2012, you can see that we've increased to 32. Year to date, from January through September 30th, you can see the trend is increasing. We had 305 calls through the end of September. So that is a 41% increase from 2011, of which we had 217, and a 78% increase over 2010, of which we had 171 through the month of September. This is just another way of showing you, in a kind of a different format. These are our yearly totals. So the very bottom is 2010, where we had 240 calls for the whole year. And in 2011, it was 286. And as you can see, through September of this year, we've already exceeded that call volume. And we have the rest of October, November, and December. So as I looked at the incident reports before I came over, we're at 317 since the end of September. So they are increasing.
Ms. Barros?
Yes.
One of the questions that I've received from the public in the past is regarding, does the fire department go on all emergency call-outs, including ambulance call-outs? And I know the answer to that question, but I thought you might want to share that so that the rest of the public could hear your response.
We do not respond with the ambulance unless they've requested us. That task is usually done by the police department. So Dusty can maybe elaborate when he's standing up here this evening, but you know, those numbers are strictly fire call responses or mutual aid responses.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay, fire prevention and public education. For the month of September, we had 79 routine inspections conducted with 50 follow-ups. There are 6 construction inspections, 5 child care. The miscellaneous was 26, And then we've had two tours, lectures, and demos for the month of September. That will greatly increase in October, as this is our very busy month with fire prevention and public education. I can report that as of today, we've seen over 600 students at the fire hall with our classes that have attended their tours and lectures, so. Here's our September activities for the volunteer fire department. We've conducted fire drills at all the local schools, with Country House requesting a fire extinguisher demonstration for their staff, and the Dickinson Press wanting a fire drill. Country House also wanted a fire drill to be conducted when we were there doing a fire extinguisher demonstration. We've started our firefighter essentials training. We have four of our new volunteers taking that certification, and we have six from surrounding departments also taking part. That certification is a state certification, and when completed, they will have a firefighter one designation. And again, there's Country House with their fire extinguisher demonstration. We had approximately 20 of their staff participating. Our regular training in September, the topic of instruction was ladder operations, search and rescue techniques. Mark and I attended an International Association Arson Investigations Seminar in Bismarck. It was 18 hours of continuing ed, and they always conduct very good training for us. Special ops training was auto extrication and trench rescue. And that is a current picture of your Dickinson Volunteer Fire Department and full-time staff. There's just one other addition to the report that wasn't in your packet, and that was from Chief Sivak. He wanted me to just let you know that we did receive the insurance premium tax distribution for fire districts, and the amount that the City of Dickinson Fire Department received was $67,000, approximately $800. So that did go into the general fund this year. Are there any other questions for us today?
Good. Thank you, Mrs. Barrows.
Ms. Barrows,
yep.
On the number of inspections, you got routine 79 and construction 6. Are we lagging behind the construction, or would 6, since such a small amount, would that be current? Would you be current in the construction inspections?
Construction inspections are when we're doing the rough-in inspections on a construction site. The routine inspections are the businesses currently operating. So for the month of September, that's all we got through.
That's all you got through, or I mean?
The construction inspections, that's
like
what
you got
we did.
Six, how many requests are there out there?
Well, construction inspections aren't necessarily a request. That's when we have time and availability of staff to get into those buildings under construction.
So your routine is gonna come first before construction inspection?
It can, mm-hmm. We've also added another fire inspector who's helping a lot with that routine inspection number. Construction inspections aren't as often for us like they are for the building code inspectors, because we are only out there maybe once on a construction, and then we're going back on sprinkler alarm tests and alarm tests and doing some finals. So we're not really out there as often as the building code on their inspections of a construction site. Where they're doing a pre-plan and looking at it from a different angle.
Okay,
does that answer your question?
Yep.
Okay. Anything else?
Ms. Barrows,
yes.
When you do construction permits, you don't go to, you're not required to attend each of the construction sites. In other words, you're not on a single family dwelling site. You mostly do commercial construction, is that accurate?
Yep, our construction inspections are commercial properties and multifamily. We're not on a residential construction site.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we have a 5 o'clock timetable agenda item. This is a public hearing for utility easement vacation. Mr. Soren, are you gonna do that?
Yes, Commissioner Jackson, that is mine. This is a utility easement vacation between lots 2 and 3, block 7, Fisher East Side Second Subdivision. This subdivision is located just west of 18th Avenue East. The developer of the lots is looking to take these four lots and create a townhouse development, which is needing to go across that property line. All the utility companies have signed off on the vacation, and we're recommending approval of the vacation.
Okay, thank you. Any commissioners have any questions? If not, this is a public hearing, so we'll open that public hearing and ask if there's anybody tonight that would like to comment on the vacation of this utility easement. Anybody from the audience, please come forward if you have comment. Okay, if not, we will close the public hearing. We probably have a resolution number.
Mr. Jackson, this will be resolution number 57-2012.
57-2012. Any commissioners have comments or would like to make a motion?
Make a motion to approve 57-2012.
Thank you, Mr. Oltmans.
Second.
Okay, any discussion on the motion? If not, we'll vote. Mr. Oltmans?
Aye.
Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. The motion carries. Let's try to get Chief Dossinger in here before we go to our next timetable agenda item.
Good evening, Mr. Vice President, members of the Commission. I have before you the September 2012 Dixon Police Department report. I will start out with accidents. We had a total of 84 traffic crashes in the month of September. One of those involved a pedestrian. 61 of those were property accidents. 3 injury accidents, 18 hit and run accidents, and unfortunately, we did have one fatality accident in the month of September. There were a total of 587 traffic stops conducted. 459 of those resulted in citations, and 190 of those were issued warnings. Comparing September from 2011 to 2012, this year we had 1,974 calls. We are down from last year, in which we had 2,152 calls for service. Year-to-date, right now we're sitting at 19,221 calls for the year at the end of September, compared to 17,152 calls for service at the end of September last year. September was a busy training month for our officers. We sent a total of 34 different employees to 8 different trainings, including bulletproof mind seminars, emergency medical dispatch training, internet crimes against children training, supervisor training, firearms instructor schools, MOCIC conference, group crisis intervention, and canine training. Starting October 30th, evening at 7 o'clock, we are reinventing the Citizens Police Academy. We haven't done this for several years. Our staff is pretty excited about that. I gave you guys a brochure prior to the meeting starting. We'd certainly like to see some department heads and some commissioners join us for this activity. It's going to be a total of 9 weeks in length. It'll be a wide variety of topics, anything from patrol procedures to defensive tactics to canine presentations. So certainly like to see you guys there. And we're shooting for between 20 to 25 participants. Right now we're about half full. If any of the citizens or you guys would like to join, you can check our website out, or you can stop by City Hall and pick up a brochure or our office and drop it off. Are there any questions?
What are the dates, Chief Dossinger? I know the 30th, but are they every week then?
Yes, they are once a week, every Tuesday at 7 o'clock.
Okay, Commissioner Altman told me I have to go, so.
Chief, I had the opportunity to go through the academy a few years back, and I would recommend it to anyone in the public. It's an excellent program. It's an interesting program, and I don't think we've had anybody that said they didn't wish they'd go through it if they have, so I'd encourage anyone to contact the chief or the police department to go through that.
Yeah, please do. My staff is very excited about it. It also does include a ride-along portion of it as well.
You know, they also give ride-alongs. Are they still doing ride-alongs for the academy people?
That's correct.
We're
planning on doing that, yeah.
Chief Dossinger, on another topic, for a long time you showed us numbers related to calls to service that were really increasing regularly. Mm-hmm. I expect they're still increasing, but have you seen it flatten out, your calls to service?
Yes, we have leveled out. One thing to keep in mind, we have several new officers that are currently undergoing the FTO program, and several of our officers are training those officers, so some of our proactive enforcement activities are down because of that.
Okay. Okay. But am I hearing you say that some of the activity that we maybe didn't like to see is leveling off a little bit?
We have leveled off, but we still are higher than we have been in the years past.
Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. Thanks very much. Anything else for Chief Dossinger? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we will move to our 505 timetable agenda item, which is a series of public hearings having to do with impact fee assessments. Who's going to introduce that topic, Mr. Soren?
I will, Commissioner Jackson. Thank you. This is the development impact fee projects that we've completed year to date that we've been able to get ready for the special assessment process. We've looked at each of these. There are a total, actually, of 8 projects here. You'll notice that Country Oaks and Painted Canyon, those were both set up with a phase 1 for underground and phase 2 for streets. We have included those together as the one assessment because of how we advertised and brought those together, so we notified the property owners one time instead of 2 separate ones to try and make it make more sense for them. We've went through the Special Assessment Commission. They've looked at the assessments that we put out. They agreed to them. We notified people and had public hearings at that board as well prior to this. The information that you have in front of you is the recommendation from the Special Assessment Commission, and we're recommending that these get approved. At the public hearings, we did have a couple of people there, not necessarily protesting the amounts, but there were some concerns about them being notified that there was going to be assessments. It's the process of the developer comes in, gets the improvement district established, and then sells the property to somebody else, and they're not being notified that they're going to have the assessments, or they missed that. And that was their only concern. I think we had 2 that came to the meeting. But other than that, we had no protests on the amounts that are being recommended for approval.
Okay. Before we open the public hearing, any commissioners have any questions of Mr. Soren? If not, we'll do that. Now, our city attorney, Mr. Kohling, is telling me that we can go ahead and take comments on all of the projects, and maybe you should list them. Did you do that? Did I miss that?
I did not, but I'll go through them. I will add that all of the projects that we have do come to be an assessment of about $2.4 million of the impact dollars. But the ones that are included are Country Oaks Estates. So we've got a phase 1 and phase 2. The Painted Canyon subdivision, phase 1 and phase 2. Washington 4th edition, phase 6. States 5th edition, State 6th edition, and 23rd Avenue East.
Okay, so we're going to open the public hearing for all those subdivisions, all those projects. If there's anybody here tonight that would like to comment on the special assessments, they should come forward, just state your name, and we'll hear what you have to say. Anybody from the public have comment on any of these assessments? Okay, it appears we have none, so we will close the public hearing. We will, however, have to have individual motions for each of the 6 items. Resolution numbers, I assume, are going to start with 58.
That's correct.
Through what, 63?
58 through 63.
So, commissioners, we'll start with the Country Oaks Estates Phase 1 and 2, which is Resolution 58-2012. Looking for a motion to approve those.
I'll make a motion to approve Resolution 58-212.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? not, we'll vote. Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
Mr. Oltmanns?
Aye.
Chair votes aye. That motion carries. Resolution 59, 2012, will address the Painted Canyon Phases 1 and 2. Do we have a motion for that project?
Motion to approve.
And a second? Mrs. Dukart, thank you. Any discussion? Not, we'll vote. Mr. Oltmanns?
Aye.
Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Motion carries. Resolution 60 would be the Washington 4th Edition Phase 6. Can we have a motion on that project?
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, we will vote. Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
Mr. Oltmanns?
Aye.
Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Chair votes aye. That motion carries. 61 is the state's 5th edition. We have a motion on that project.
Move to approve.
And a second?
Second.
Okay. Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Oltmanns?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Motion carries. 62 is the state's 6th edition.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay. We'll vote. Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Oltmanns?
Aye.
Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
Chair votes aye. That motion carries. And the last one, Resolution 63, is 23rd Avenue East. Can we have a motion for that one?
Move to approve.
Aye.
Second.
Or second.
Okay, we will vote. Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
And Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Oltmanns?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. That motion carries. Okay. No, I think we're close enough here at 5:15 that we'll move into a discussion that we thought was appropriate concerning hotels, motels in Dickinson. I think Mr. Kessel is going to introduce that topic with maybe some help from Mr. Cortan. And then I expect some commissioners probably have some things to say about this topic as well. Mr. Kessel, do you want to start us?
Thank you, Commissioner Jackson. As we all know, in 2011, the city of Dickinson was the fourth fastest growing small city in the nation. And that has not changed in 2012. We're far exceeding that growth in 2012. And part of that growth includes what I think can be only termed as an explosion in hotel rooms that are available in Dickinson or being planned for the city of Dickinson. We did have a brief discussion of this at a previous city commission meeting. We were asked to put it on the commission again for a public hearing. The CVB was specifically invited to make a request this evening. And we did receive a letter, which has been distributed to all of you as commissioners, from a hotel owner here in town. Some numbers were put together for comparison purposes by the planning department. And what I'd like to do is turn the floor over to Planner Cortan, and he can make some further comments about that research.
Thank you, Vice Chair, and also the commissioners. With respect to the, I updated the data that I had provided for you back in August, and kind of cleaned up a little bit of it based upon some of the discussions that I had, and I provided that for you. I had the original document, and then I put this over the top of it. As of 2012, the existing hotels that we have right now that are existing and under construction, I have approximately 17. The existing rooms that are being built and are under construction at 1332. And then below that, I have listed numbers of potential rooms and the general location of the hotels of different proprietors that have spoken to me over the last year. And if you add up those total number, the total number of hotels potentially that could come through without, if it came to fruition, would be 27 hotels and roughly 2,397 rooms. You know, those are estimates. Some of these may not happen, but I've spoken to just about every single one. and I feel the numbers are fairly accurate with respect to that. So that provides you some more updated data with respect to looking at the total number of hotels that we have for our city. Also above that, the same number of the, I had five other communities in which we polled that were roughly the size of between 40 and 45,000 that were next to a major interstate, to give you some comparison to see for a city of our size where we would be in the future, to give you an idea of total number of rooms and the hotels associated with that. As you could tell, that the city of Dickinson, based upon that, will be significantly higher than any of those polled, and then also the total number of rooms will exceed that as well. So with that, I can answer any questions the commissioners may have.
Let me start with a couple of questions, if I could, Mr. Corton. So summarizing your numbers, it appears that if all these proposed motels were built, that we'd be increasing our number of hotels as well as the number of rooms by, looks to me like about 60 or 70% from what we have right now.
That would be true.
Okay, can you tell us of the 10 hotels that you're listing as potential projects, do you actually have building permit applications on some of those?
We have a building permit application for the homestay. We've had discussions with the extended stay towards the bottom, the Roars hotels. I've met with them in general discussions, but the only one that submitted a complete set that's under review and pretty close to being issued is the homestay at this point. The two Marriott hotels are under review, our third-party review in Grand Forks. They're reviewing that. We do have some issues with respect to some civil issues, but so the homestay in the two Marriott hotels at 29th and Highway 22, we have under review at this point.
Okay. Any questions right now from commissioners? Any other questions?
Mr. Corton, did you get a chance to get the Williston numbers?
I did not.
You know, I see the comparison up, you know, the five you give us up there, and I don't know if that's a fair comparison because of our energy fill here and so on. You know, so, you know, I think a fair comparison would be Williston, Minot, maybe somewhere else in Pennsylvania where there's activity, or, you know, the same type of activity that we're getting here. That's what would be, you know, beneficial to me, I guess, you know,
right,
as far as numbers go. Obviously, this is something we invited the hotel people to come and talk about, and, you know, our concern is their concern and vice versa. I mean, the city, you know, we remember when the boom went bust and what the community was held with and so on, and, you know, I think that's something that we got to keep in back of our mind is to, you know, what do we have to do in the event that this happens again, and, you know, whether we can actually control someone coming in and saying can build or cannot build. You know, I have reservations about that, but I think it's good discussion that we're having now, and, you know, we talked last meeting about having a database to give these companies when they come in and they're interested in the hotels. So I'd like to see a few more communities in there, but I know you have nothing to do, but
I'll add it to my list.
Thank you.
Well, I'd like to hear comments from the CVB too also. It's a free market. Do we have the right to say you can't come in? You know, that's, I don't know. The other thing is, how do you pick and choose? You know, like, when I'm looking at this list, Dakota Diner, we have 100 or more trucks there. They would definitely like a motel within walking distance. You know, the needs are there for some of these, but I would like to hear from the public.
Okay, and we'll do that. Any commissioners, anything else for now?
I'd like to hear the comments, and then we can further the discussion from there.
Sure. So let's do that. We really would like input on this question. Do you think there is a concern, a legitimate concern? If there is a concern, should a city step in and do anything about it, a city government step in and do anything about it? And if so, what would that be? And we'll just open it up. Anybody that wants to speak, come on forward and state your name. We'd really like to know your thoughts. Ms. Thiel.
Good evening. I'm Terry Thiel, Executive Director of the Dickinson Convention Visitors Bureau. Currently, we were polling and holding some meetings prior to this to find out what the discussion would be among the hotel and motel GMs and owners. And so we had our monthly meeting, I think the end of September, after the first meeting here. We talked about it then. I asked them to take back information per the discussion that had gone on earlier in September and visit, talk about it. Then we did meet again, I believe it was last Friday, and I said, you know, you'd be asked to come and meet again. So as far as our board, we have not had an opportunity to go back to make any, you know, determination. We want to hear from the industry. Obviously, we're the middleman, per se, bring the business in. These are the ones that have got the real property into this. And so right now, at this point, you know, we have not talked about it other than bring the information again to our board that I'm informing them. Obviously, you know, sitting at our end of it, we would have, you know, concerns, but I think it needs to be information coming back and dialogue directly, more so between them than our organization right now. You know, we look at bringing the business into town. There's going to be obviously more need to be more planning on things that we need in town to attract things, whether it be events and or attractions, even outgrowing ourselves that we are even at this current pace right now. So I can't say that we have an official position on anything. I think we need to wait, even as our organization, we get done here tonight, listen to the dialogue that's going on. You know, I think any community that sees the type of growth right now, whether it's Williston or Minot or Watford City ourselves, you know, it's a lot coming at us very quickly. So, you know, we look ahead into the future and trying to find that optimum balance. And so I think at this point right now, I'd like to obviously let some of this other dialogue take place. And then I'll answer any questions, too, if you have any specific, you know, questions. I do have some information on Williston on the numbers that I can get Mr. Corton to.
Thank you, Ms. Thiel. Anybody have any questions?
Have you been able to book conventions, or are the motels full?
Well, with the conventions, most of the time that goes out a couple years. Mm-hmm. So we've been able to work, you know, working ahead in the years, 2 to 3 to 4 years out. And of course, when we put those bids together at that time, then we ask for a bid that would we feel that could be competitive against another city. And especially now coming in this fall, we've been very pleased with that. We are again offering state rates some of the hotels, and so with that part of it, you know, we're able to work ahead in those years. So that's a little bit different than maybe our walk-ins right now too.
Have we lost any events or conventions because of the occupancy rate?
There were some earlier this year that we have, and part of it has been you know, some of the bidding ability on the pricing. And it has been a factor for that. It's need to be more education as far as working with those groups to make sure that we can get out those years ahead and make sure that those are blocked. So that's probably a little bit more work on that part. And obviously right now we're probably working on, need to work a little bit harder now on the room availability. We have some more rooms coming online, as is Williston too. So people calling ahead, we still ask pre-planning. But a lot of it's for us is working ahead now. I think we had a little bit tougher time earlier this summer with it.
Okay. How are we looking for this hunting season as far as availability?
That was open this year, and that was the first time since I've been here that we've had open rooms. And we delivered out hunting packets and that, but, you know, our marketing was changed a little bit this last year also, dramatically.
Okay.
Ms. Thiel, getting away from the convention side of it, tourism, how did we do this year? I mean, we have any problems splitting up the tourists? Did we have to turn some away, or?
You know, our office works real closely with the hotels every week on those faxes, and those groups of managers work very closely together. If they're not able to provide a room, they'll call ahead, and we actually work out into the area. We've done that for a couple of years, but I was very pleased with the walk-in travel. You know, and again, maybe some of the pricing was out of a little bit, you know, difference, and that's the entire western area than what some of them were used to. I have visited with some of them in Medora. They had a very good year. They were very pleased with it, and like I said, I was pleased with the amount of walk-ins we did see.
Of the occupancy percentages, what would you say with the tourism versus just regular rooms would be?
That I don't have.
70, 30, 80,
20? Yeah, that I don't have for you.
Other questions? Thanks, Ms. Thiel.
Okay, thank you.
Who else would like to speak to this topic?
Hello, my name is Melissa Johnson. I'm the general manager at the Comfort Inn here in Dickinson. I've been in that position for the last 8 years. First off, we'd like to tell you as an industry, thank you for asking for our opinion on this whole thing that we've got going on. You'll hear from a couple other hotel managers and possibly some owners coming up. My opinion differs from most of everybody else's, and mine is actually my owner's opinion. We are owned by a gentleman by the name of Perry Miller out of Wahpeton. And his question was, he's more concerned about the free enterprise, and do you start limiting just hotels, or are there other businesses that you're concerned about overgrowth on as well? So he's a little bit concerned about that. He wanted to know if I could bring back to him what prompted the why just hotels? You know, why not?
I think we need to clarify that we aren't even thinking about eliminating anything here. I mean, that's the last thing that we're thinking about.
But changing the permitting, right?
Well, we're talking about how, if it continues how it is, how could it affect the city if this thing turns again? You know, so, yeah, free enterprise and so on. I don't think you're going to have an argument up here with that.
Okay.
And there's not an ordinance in the works. There's nothing on the table. It was brought to the commission as a concern, and rather than us five who are not in the hotel industry making a decision, we thought let's open it up to the hotel industry, have that discussion, and will it go anywhere? Don't know, but at least we'll have had the discussion and be better informed moving forward.
Which is totally understandable. He, like I said, his vote would be that if you change it to a special permitting, he's more curious about what you would ask the new hotel, you know, what would be your premises on issuing a special permit, and wondering if you thought any further into that. Or, lacking for my words right now. That was his main question, is what you would look for special permitting if you do change it to that. And I think that was his take on it, that he would like to see.
That's a good point, because kind of from what I can see about him, this is probably out in left field, but in his case, he may be thinking about building another one here, and he has a concern, is are we going to cut him off when he's already out of business here? So.
And I don't know what he's thinking. You know, he wishes he could be here. He actually sits on the county commission in Richland County, and so he had a commission meeting this morning. Otherwise, he was thinking about driving out. So just what if you do decide to do it, I guess what some of those parameters would be.
I think we haven't put anything on the table at this point, and again, opening up for discussion. I know that in other communities, for instance, in Texas, that had the same issue. One of the tweaks that they did was future hotels had to have a minimum number of rooms, had to have a restaurant, had to have a minimum meeting space.
Irving, Texas, right?
Yeah, in Irving, Texas. And that was one direction they went, more towards full-service hotels coming online in the future. again, nothing's been put on the table, was raised, and these are good questions that you're asking, and I think this is where we're at, is just in the information gathering process, so.
Okay. I will let somebody else give you their opinion on it.
Okay.
Thank you. Who else would like to speak?
Hello, I'm Chris Urban. I'm the general manager of the new La Quinta Inn and Suites that just opened over behind Country Kitchen. I think what the concern is in our area at this point, all these hotels that want to come into town, the 17 or 10 more that are being proposed, I think what they're really looking at are the last year or the last 2 year star reports, where unfortunately there have not been rooms available because of us being so booked of contracted oil field rooms. What we've been seeing here lately is a break in that, where the housing has finally caught up for these oil companies, where they are able to build apartments, able to get into houses, and they are moving out of the hotels. So our industry is shifting to more availability now. The prices are lowering because of that, and that's what we need in this town to bring in visitors, in my opinion. If we keep building 10 more hotels, I really fear that we're going to end up like Minot and Williston, where we're going to have, you know, hundreds of open rooms a night, and quite possibly, like the study in Irving showed, that some of those older hotels start turning into meth labs and low-income housing. And I really think that we need to be careful how many are proposed. I'm not saying to cut it off completely, is my opinion. I'm just saying 10 at once or 4 at once is a bit overdramatic. I think we should maybe go one at a time as the population is growing. And going along with that, we're obviously going to need something in town, as in more restaurants, more activities to bring in these conventions. You see restaurants closing in town, and it just seems kind of backwards compared to what we need to bring in these conventions. So that's my standpoint on it.
What do you think of location-wise? You know, as we heard out by Dakota Diner, where there's a truck stop, might be a good location. When you look at the new development that's heading to the west of our town, where there'll be shopping, it seems that hotels would go hand in hand with shopping as our city expands. And so when you're looking at location versus number and where people will serve, what's your take on that? When you take out just the raw number of hotels, but where you look at where the need is?
I feel obviously location is the biggest thing along the interstates. A lot of these hotels that are proposed that are coming in town, you know, they're choosing the cheapest land that they can, building a no-name hotel because they know they're going to be able to make enough to pay off their property in a year with these contracted oil rooms. Something out by the truck stop, if there was more shopping and whatnot, I guess I don't know the numbers of truckers that require hotel rooms. I don't know how many stay in their trucks or whatnot, but a gradual increase I don't think would hurt.
Okay. So you would say that there are still probably some key locations that would be better or served by hotels, and it would be a likely place for them to happen, but part of the danger is when a hotel just pops up in any neighborhood or any area, and right. And if we look back at our history and we look back at where Evergreen is, the retirement home, that was a hotel. And if you think back to the history of our community, it was kind of off the beaten path, and right. It was one of the first ones, you know, not to make it. And so do we look at a location by location, or what's your take on that?
I think location by location would be a good standpoint on it. And I think they need to focus on brand name hotels too. You know, if you have a bunch of no-name hotels coming in here, you know, they're not going to put in their marketing efforts to get that hotel going and keep it going. You know, they're just, in my opinion, they're going to build as cheap as they can to fill it up with oil field workers, and whatever happens, happens. They're not held up to any brand standards at that point.
Okay. So when you looked at financing for your hotel, and obviously you were looking at the star reports and you were looking at the occupancy, and that wasn't the only thing that allowed you to get the financing to come in and build. One of our discussions that we had is making sure that any hotel that's coming in the future would have the most up-to-date information, so that they're not looking at the last 2 years thinking that is the trajectory that right. we're on. I think that's an important aspect of it too.
What was the question? What did we look at specifically?
Yeah, you looked at something other than the STAR report. How did you determine that the Dickinson was going to be a good location for your hotel?
Can I bring up our owner for
yeah.
the question? I wasn't as involved
sure.
in the pre-opening other than a few months beforehand.
Sure.
Well, my name is Chuck Hayes, and I'm part of the ownership of the La Quinta. And I guess that, three of my partners are from Dickinson.
Okay.
And I guess, we, started looking at this, a long time ago. At that time, there was, greater need here. And I guess, we were looking at, location. And like when you were asking Chris about location, from a hotel standpoint, we look at, location number one, your highways we look at. Then we look for gas stations and food.
Mm-hmm.
Because those are two things when people are traveling, that are really, for a need, And then I guess like Chris said too, we were looking at the oil thing, but the same token, we were looking at what's going to happen when oil starts going away.
Mm-hmm.
And so, we looked at doing something medium-sized instead of oversized, so as things trend down, like Chris said, they're going now, we've got to depend on the traveling public and the people coming to Dickinson.
Answer this, I guess, hypothetical. You looked at building your hotel a couple of years ago and went through the motions of getting
yes.
the financing and the building. If you were coming in today and you were trying to get the financing for a hotel, do you think that has tightened up based on the demand here too? Will that start to circumvent some of the hotel expansion just based on being able to get the financing?
Financing in the motel industry, that's basically all I do. I'm involved in Bismarck, Fargo, Minot. And, financing for motels actually is pretty hard.
Right.
And I'd say, I talked to a lot of people in the industry, and most people I find they're building now, they're getting financing from out of this area because the financing is not really available.
Mm-hmm.
And your federal regulators now are, they've gone back because of the credit meltdown back in 07, 08, 09. They started looking at saturation of banks. And when they talk about saturation, is what do they have in dollars in different types of development, like strip malls, C-stores, motels. And the feds are basically, telling them they only have so many percent in each type of thing. And typically in North Dakota, just all motels basically been financed locally or
mm-hmm.
in the state.
Right.
So really right in North Dakota right now, there's very few dollars that are available for hotel motels really.
So is that going to somewhat curtail new hotels being built in Dickinson? Because, I know that our local bankers, if they looked at this, they probably wouldn't touch a new hotel.
No, they wouldn't touch it.
Right.
So
will it be a problem that will resolve itself? And
well, I think what it's going to do is going to force outsiders to come in. People are going to come in looking, basically for thinking they make a quick dollar.
Okay.
Not looking at something long term. Because they'll probably bring financing with them from an area that's distressed. And, I guess, probably my business, half my time spent working with bankers. And typically, I've been working on Wilson for 2 years, and every day I have a different opinion what I should do up there. And I'm scared more times than not, I guess. And, we're involved in Minot, too. We have two properties there, and, Minot, we're seeing the same trend as we are in Dickinson. But probably a couple months ago, the oil company started pulling back, and they basically kind of left the city almost because, they're going to more man camps or, apartment buildings have gone up. Probably a larger scale of what they are here.
Sure.
And I think last year, 12 new motels opened up in Minot. There's another 8 or 10 under construction now. So Minot is going to, Minot, I feel right now, is getting way overbuilt. And most of the people are building there now are people from out of state or out of the region.
Okay.
You talked about location, too. We have a new hospital going up in a couple of years to be ready for occupancy. So for every hospital I've ever gone to, they've always had hotels and motels around within walking distance, so how do you feel about that?
I look back now, I look at Fargo, that's where I'm from, and our two main hospitals in Fargo, are uptown, and there isn't any motels around them, really, except for, there's nothing within walking distance of them. And, from a motel standpoint, hotels aren't, I don't think hospitals are really large, drivers of revenue or rooms rented, because typically when people are in hotels, they're gonna be staying with friends, Ronald McDonald House, or they're gonna be looking for maybe long-term type, places to stay, because a lot of times it's day in, day out, or, because, as you go with procedures now, insurance companies kind of limit what happens, people are leaving the hospitals before they should. But every area is different, and they built a new one in Jamestown, and I don't think I've really seen anything in Jamestown change. I think there's one new motel going to get built in front of Walmart now, in Jamestown, and nothing's really happened out by the new one there, because I think, what's there is, taking care of the needs for Jamestown already.
I would like to hear from the hotel industry, not at this meeting, but something to take back and to discuss. And Mr. Kessel and I met with some members of the liquor establishments last week, and part of their concern was we talked about motels and so on, and part of the concern is that the revenue stream from a lounge is considered a pretty good revenue stream right now. How do we address that situation? Do we limit the size of lounges in some of these here, new ones that would come on, if they're less than so many rooms? Do we say per square foot, this is what you're allowed for a lounge? I'd be interested to see what you're
I guess from in. My standpoint, I've always had bad outcomes when I've been involved with alcohol and food. So I've always tried to stay with the limited, you need to stay with what you're good at. And I know when I talk to a lot of people that are in the motel industry that have bars, restaurants, a lot of times, on an average, the motel is subsidizing the bar and the restaurant. I think the bar side maybe does all right, but the restaurant side, suffers because of what their costs are. Unless you can have a large place like some of your older Holiday Expresses and things like that. But in the industry now for motels, you don't really see a lot of large full-service hotels being built, unless you're in a large metropolitan area.
Well, the point being that the liquor industry has the same concern as you guys do. You overbuild the motels, you overbuild the liquor industry also.
Yes.
But we need to have the people from the convention bureaus talk to us about that too, that have the eating and the drinking establishments. And since I'm sitting here looking at you, can we have some opinions from you too? Okay.
Yeah, do we have any other questions of these two gentlemen? If not, thank you both much for being
here.
And
thank you. Thanks for inviting us.
Comments.
Thank you.
Anybody else would like to speak to this?
Good evening. My name is Dominic Goodman. I'm the Assistant General Manager at Ramada Grand Dakota Lodge, as well as the Human Resource Manager. I'd like to address two points. The first point pretty much is what Chris talked about, is what is the reason for the hotels being overbooked at this period in time? We might all look and say it's because of the oil industry, but the mere fact is due to the quick inburst or the quick influx of workers at that point in time, where we had such a small population and not sufficient housing, would cause workers had to stay in a hotel and create that occupancy at a high level. Now, as Chris also mentioned, that as workers start or the companies start to find better housing, they are pulling away and putting their workers in or building their own camps, where we have already seen a decrease in occupancy as well as ADR. And I'm North Dakota ready, being a very pretty much low unemployment rate state. On you have wages with a sky high and trying to compete with competitive wages, making it impossible for companies as well as hotels to be able to function when you have income decreasing but expense going up. How do you compete against oil companies who has, and as well as man camps who pay in host keepers $15 to $20 an hour, where you have a decrease in occupancy as well as revenue? And that's something we definitely look at. Yeah, we compare with Texas and could compare with other states, but those states are pretty much larger, and as well as they might have had the sufficient housing in place before the boom even happened, whereas in our case, in our situation, we did not, and thus causing us to have house workers in the hotel as well as pretty much higher rates and stuff as well. So yeah, we could say demand and supply and look at it from an economic standpoint, but when we look at it from a consumer standpoint, they're looking at it as scarcity and opportunity cost, whereas they came in here, they preferably might have wanted to have their workers in housing rather than hotels, but because of the scarcity of of rooms and availability of houses, thus costing them have to put their workers in hotels as well. Do they want to put their workers in hotel for the rest of the oil boom? No. I mean, all of them probably doing their budget right now and coming up with solutions and probably better strategy to better host their workers. So, I mean, yeah, we could foresee the city pretty much advancing to about 45,000 people in the next 5 to 10 years, but is those people going to be looking for hotel rooms, or are they looking for someplace to stay? You know, and that's something is actually a really huge concern for the hotel industry, and I do feel that it could destroy the industry in some point. You know, you could do your competitive analysis and consumers' wants and consumers' needs, but right now our consumer, or pretty much when you look at who is coming in, is more workers rather than travelers. And in right, we're at the point now where even if travelers come in, we do have availability, and we have seen a decrease in occupancy as well. So those are the points I would like to address from, I mean, as a representative of Ramada Grand Dakota Lodge Conference Center.
Thank you.
Mr. Goodman, can I ask a question?
Yes.
We just heard from Mr. Hayes that oftentimes restaurants and bars are subsidized by hotel revenues. You just recently rebranded your restaurant not long ago, and you just completed a upgrade to your bar.
Yeah.
Is that true for you?
You know, to be honest, when we look, because we have, like, we do have both together, I mean, they operate. When you look at it, a lot of times having a lounge within the hotel, you mean marketing, if someone haven't already been in the area, it's tough for them to actually know that it exists. So a lot of times it's more of the guests utilizing your facility rather than the community. And that's something we definitely saw. When you're comparing a bar with a lounge, I think there is some type of difference, because technically a bar person just go to a bar for a different setting as well, whereas in our lounge is more directed towards our guests. And for them to have something during the event of winters and stuff, you don't want to go out in the community. You have something in the hotel as well. But we do, our restaurant, it has somewhat a bit of a different function from the lounge, but together they do cooperate and work as one.
So do those two operations, are they a revenue stream for your hotel, or are they an expense stream? Well, and maybe you can't answer. I see you.
Lane probably could answer better, but we do either see rooms and banquets more.
I'm Elaine Myron, the general manager. The hotel revenue does subsidize more for the restaurant. The food expense is a lot bigger than your lounge would be. So to answer that question.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
Okay. Okay.
Very much.
Thanks.
Anyone else? Anyone else want to speak to the hotel question? Okay. Well, we want to thank you all for being here. It's been said a number of times. The only reason that this topic, I believe, came up is that we're seeing the potential proliferation of many motels, possibly. I don't think, as a commission, my opinion, we want to be so involved in the business aspects of that. In other words, the marketplace has to take care of itself. We want to see every business in Dickinson be successful. I think our concern is, will it affect taxpayers? Will it affect the quality of our community? Some of those kinds of questions. In an extreme place, in an extreme case, could we have blighted properties some years down the road? And those kinds of things. We want you all to be successful, but I don't think that's something that a city government should be directly involved in. So I think we're going to be very, very cautious with anything that we do, and rightfully so. It's been stated, but everybody should know that we have no pending action plan. There is nothing planned. We want to think about this. We want to hear what you have to say. We just want to be on top of this as we're trying to be with the rest of the growth issues that our community is working forward with at this time. More comments by commissioners? Any questions, or shall we move on?
I think it's great dialogue, and I think we should leave it open if they'd like to come back and discuss it again.
Absolutely.
Now, I guess I would just further state, everyone on this commission is a business owner and believes in the free enterprise system. And so that is certainly not the discussion that we're having here. I think we were wanting to be more proactive in not having future hotels, I guess, to take from the business I am in investing. Past results don't indicate what future results will be. And so for them to be building their premise on 2010, 11, and 12 STAR reports is a misnomer. And so we want to make sure that any new hotel coming online has the most up-to-date information, the most up-to-date projections of where business is heading, so that they're making a good, informed decision based on what tentatively future results are going to be for their business model. It would be unjust for us to be courting hotels based on past performance, and again, we want to just make sure that they have the most update information, whether it be through the CVB or through our existing hotel, so that they're making a good informed decision moving forward.
Anyone else? If not, we're going to move on to Public Works and Planning. Item 6A is a rezoning request. We're going to hear the second reading tonight for rezoning of Sundance Village and the Sundance Coves. Mr. Quinton?
Thank you, Vice Chair, Commissioners. This is a rezone petition from Ag to Planning and Development. Including your packet materials are the illustrations of the zoning districts that would be located for the two subdivisions. The Village subdivision is approximately 308 acres and is located 1 mile to the east of the intersection at 10th Avenue, 10th Avenue East and 21st Street. This consists of residential and commercial zoning districts within the PUD. The Cove subdivision is located southwesterly of the property. It is approximately 40 acres and it has 91 lots. The Planning and Zoning Commission and city staff recommend approval contingent upon the two conditions of approval that are described within the adopting ordinance. There are no changes from the first reading.
Okay, and again, I'd remind us all that this is actually second reading. We've already passed the first reading for this ordinance. Because it is an ordinance, we will ask if there's anybody from the public that wants to speak about this rezoning request. Nobody from the public? Any comments by commissioners, or are you ready to make a motion?
Make a motion to approve second reading and final passage of ordinance number 1486.
Do we have a second? Okay, we have a motion, second. Any discussion about this second reading? From anybody? If not, we'll vote. Mr. Oltmans?
Aye.
Mrs. Dukart?
Aye.
Mr. Steiner?
Aye.
Chair votes aye. Motion carries. Okay, that takes us to code enforcement report, I believe. And, you know, maybe what we'll do, Mr. Curtin, is before you give your code enforcement report, I know we moved the hair-off annexation issue to item C here. I think we've got a number of people. Why don't we do that one first?
Sure, Vice Chair. The next item is we have proponents in the audience today that have petitioned the city to include their property as part of an annexation. Their property is located in the northwest quadrant just outside the city limits, to the south of 34th Street West, and to the west of State Avenue. It is approximately 320 acres. City staff is seeking direction tonight from the commission on how you want to proceed with this annexation. We also have several other annexations that are in the queue that are within the urban growth areas that we had talked about and the commission recently adopted. And just want to get direction from the commission on how you want to proceed with that. I provided several options for you to consider tonight. One option, as was noted in the summary, that you could decide to hear this petition at the next meeting, or you could continue this petition until a future date, depending on the dialogue that you have tonight, or you could hold off on the petition until the comprehensive plan is finished. We're looking at the projected date of having that completed somewhere between January and February of next year. So those are three options for the commission to decide tonight, whichever way you want to proceed with that. And with that, I'm available to answer any questions.
Okay, and then I would add, we don't have a resolution before us tonight, so it's not our intent to take action, and I understand that the developer is aware of that. I also think it'd be good questions like this to have a full commission before we do that. Having said that, we'll ask if the developer wants to make a statement. Do you have anything that you want to say right now, any of the commissioners?
I'd like to hear from the developer.
Okay. Mr. Cook.
Good evening, commissioners. Mike Cook. I'm going to be one of the developers involved in the project. I think I could probably answer what you need, I guess.
Well, I think we'd like to have you maybe just tell us about the development. What are you looking at? What kind of land use? What kind of timetable? Tell us.
Well, I think first off, we're going to look at developing the property similar to my development I have, Cook Metal Hills subdivision. We think it's a fantastic fit for the city. Road access being accessible from three sides, State Street, 115th Avenue, 34th Street. We've done some studies. We brought along an engineer with serving it for some utilities, the sewer and the water. We've had that checked out and tested, and we at this time feel that the majority of the property can be serviced through some of the provisions that we made when we did the Cook subdivision, the Cook Metal Hills subdivision. We think that at this time, the timetable is now. We would like to get this going, and we'd probably look at doing this in different phases, probably three different phases, depending upon, of course, how the sales and the interest has been, which has already been quite phenomenal. So we're looking at having at least a master plan together within the next 30 to 60 days. And we'd like to come in and probably present, depending upon how it goes, up to a third of it for development. We're looking at different types of zoning, and I think around the 34th Avenue and the 115th Street, we'd probably be looking at the CC commercial and some of the LC, which Mr. Jackson had suggested, and we think that's probably going to be a pretty great zoning that we're going to be looking at. We'd also like to tear down into the R3, some R3, some R2, and R1. And I think the mix that we had used in our previous development really worked out well that way, because the interest was pretty even amongst all of the mixes at this point in time. That development is about 80 to 85% sold out. We were up today doing a check on it. All the streets, curb, sewer, water, Everything's completed except for the streets, the paving. We've probably got another 2 weeks to remaining in it. I think the generation of building permits is probably going to start increasing pretty heavily because a lot of the closings we had were dependent upon sewer and water and, of course, the infrastructure being completed, which it is now. So we feel there's still a big need for this development. It's a great fit. Virtually no expense to the city whatsoever. We can service, again, everything through some of the provisions we made in our previous development here. So we feel the timing is very important and would like to keep it moving as quickly as we can.
I have one question for you. You know, tonight we allocated basically the last of the development impact fees. So moving forward, I would guess that there are not going to be development impact fees available for this, which means as a developer, you will be solely responsible for curb, street, gutter infrastructure. And so I want you to know that moving forward, that at this point, it would look like our development impact fee program has been tapped out.
If you remember correctly, my fourth division didn't have any
right.
development fees, so we're well aware of that going into this, and we're not requesting any whatsoever. We're going to do it internally. I think we've got a great group of guys involved in this project. You, as it gets going, you'll probably get and see the familiar faces, so that's not of any concern of ours at all.
Okay.
And I think that's what we're trying to present, is that we are willing to put this together with as little expense as very possible to the city of Dickinson.
Okay. For this development, is there going to be a need for a lift station or any infrastructure from the city standpoint, Sean?
Well, currently, the majority of what he's talking about is there is a lift station in the Cook Meadow Hills.
Right.
And part of that design did accommodate for this and potentially taking it back to a new sewer main that would be in State Avenue. So I think what he's referring to is this would flow into that lift station. Currently, it would use the existing system, but is set up to be able to tie into a future sewer if State Avenue or when State Avenue is constructed to deal with the issues. So the majority of it, as far as the far west side, I haven't looked at it that close to see what the issues, if another lift station would be needed there or not.
And I think as that gets going, obviously, if we're going to need one, we're going to need one. Now, our engineers, and if you have any questions, Mr. Manchester is here from Tolman Engineering, has talked with Apex about all of this. So I guess it depends upon where the city's future system is going to be going. And the way we understand it is as that gets going is about when we'd be ready for it, we'd be able to tie into it. And Mr. Soren has worked with us on that also. So,
okay. So you're comfortable knowing those logistics are out there and that they'll need to be addressed at a later date as well?
Yes.
Okay. My only question, then I'll shut up, is the Haroff addition, when we looked at scenario A, B, and C for the future growth of our community, was one of those developments that was not in all three scenarios. So when we did the Sundance annexation, it was a little easier to approach because we knew no matter what scenario we went with, it was a given. This one is on the fringe, and so I guess I'd ask the other commissioners about that, knowing that this one is.
Well, I think if we look at what we've been seeing in the 2013 plans and so on, that is the area that the city wants to grow.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we've discussed that, you know, we do have the boundaries, but it's not, you know, drawn in the sand, those boundaries.
Right.
Obviously, I think this is a good fit for the city and the way we want to go with the future school maybe there and so on. But, you know, at first I didn't know if we wanted to do this here. But driving out there and look at it, I think it's a great fit with your project across.
And I fully agree with you. It's just a great fit all around.
Yep. And tying into our plan of another system going south there. I mean, that we would discuss that would be where this would eventually lead into. But is Ms. Johnson here? You had a question on, she's not here, is she? Maybe you can help me. You had a question on the impact fees, and we're at $318,000 for a balance. How much is being returned on a monthly basis?
If and maybe Mr. Soren can address that, because you tonight approved those development impact fees.
The balance was $318,000 after.
Right. So, Mr. Soren, maybe you can address that quicker than I.
Well, a couple of points. We didn't approve any impact fees tonight. We approved the assessments of already established fees.
Money. Yep.
So it's already money that's been spent. At the rate that those come back for, you know, residential property, it's a 10-year assessment. So for commercial, it's 5. So it's you know, 1/10 of that, $230,000 plus a year would be coming back. The residential side of those impact fees, if you remember the program, it's total of $7 million, $4 million residential, $3 million commercial industrial. We have maxed out the residential side. It's the commercial industrial that was still available in that. Now, I believe the ordinance does allow us to change that allocation within for residential or commercial, but not go above the $7 million on paid out.
But what you're indicating is, regardless of impact fees or not, that you would be ready to move forward with the development and shoulder all the costs as well.
Yes, sir. Yes.
I have a question for Mr. Koch. We are short of R1s right now, lots. How many are you going to do with the R1s?
Well, as of this week, I still have about 30 or 40 left that we could sell you.
Really?
I think that, you know, without getting the big picture of what we're doing, we're ready to sit down and start designs actually tomorrow, probably. We got the flyby all done and all that information in. I mean, I think at this point, if you take it in comparison to what I have in my property, you're probably going to be looking at in the neighborhood of around 300 to 350 R1s in that particular area. That's what we'd probably be shooting for through the whole 320 acres. So, again, I think the mix that we did, which was more R1s, medium R2s, medium R3 in the commercial, so far has been a great mix. I mean, it's just really worked well.
Well, we just don't want to get saturated with R3s. You know, we've got so many apartment buildings going up all over. So, and we have requests every day for R1 lots, so I didn't realize you had 30 to 40. Okay.
They're just finishing up the paving on it, like I said, in the next week or so, that the whole development should be totally completed and ready to go. And we drove through today. It looks great, I think. So hopefully we can have some more out there that are ready. The lift station was up and pumped on Thursday and Friday, so it's all ready to go. And again, I just the piece of property that's here with the straight up from the roar stuff, and I agree with Mr. Steiner, the city going to the northwest is obviously the way that things are probably going to progress. And again, with 34 State Street, the truck route, it's just a great fit for the town.
I think the question that we're going to have to answer as a city is, when is enough annexation enough? We did 3/4 2 weeks ago. We currently have ground at various stages of development within city limits that could accommodate 15,000 people. And with that in mind, I think we have to be careful with our decision about future annexation. So that's what we have to contemplate. I think all of you know that I've stated before, I think this is a really nice piece of ground, would be a great addition to the city. But we may have to preempt that feeling with our take on what's been annexed and when is too much, when we do too much. So I think that's what we'll be up against, whether it's 2 weeks ago, 2 weeks from now, or at some later date. Mr. Corton has posed those three options to you, and unless you'd like to hear more from the developer, I think that's some of the discussion that we have to have. Mr. Kessel?
Commissioner Jackson, just a detail question. Mr. Cook, as your proposal to move forward and you move to platting, assuming annexation occurs, please keep in mind that states will be extended north and that we're going to need right away to make that happen.
I think we've done a lot of homework on this, and of course, being involved in our other projects, we're pretty much aware of all the right-of-ways that are necessary. And hopefully, in the last development, we worked with the city. I think we've done about everything the city has ever asked of us into that development. So we're here to stay. We're here to bring a good product. And I can understand Mr. Jackson's reservations about the annexation, but you also don't want to slow things down. You have to realize that taking this piece of property isn't going to be, everything's going to be there tomorrow. You know, you're looking at 6, 7, 8 months to go through planning and zoning, designs, bid processes, another 6, 7, 8 months to get the property ready to put up for sale. So if you, and again, without any expense whatsoever to the city, you've got to look at that. And of course, also the way things are now, timing is of importance. I mean, these types of products or properties and developments are really going to still be needed by your city. Whether they stick around 1 year or 2 years, I think most developers are going to be smart enough to know and take their projections out over 5, 6, 7, 8 years. So I mean, it's not like it's a short-term thing. It's kind of a long-term thing that, you know, they're going to sit around and take care of those developments until they obviously get built out for the city.
Mr. Cook, question for you. How would you feel about a process where we annex this ground or any other ground a piece at a time as it's platted, as you phase it, with some kind of an assurance that your platting process is not wasted, that it would in fact be annexed, as opposed to annexing 320 acres in one fell swoop?
Good question. I think we went through this on mine. And if I remember correctly, we were going to come in with different types of phases in that development, but I think it was you who said we should annex it all. Point being is I'm very glad that we did go through that route, because if we would have kept going into the particular phases this year, I would have probably only had a third of what I had done, and then we'd be starting that whole process over again. Now you're looking at another year to a year and a half. I think it was one of the best moves to annex that whole piece of property at one time. It was a diligent move, I guess, on my part to go through the hassle and the expense, which I agreed to take, and develop it all at one time, just because of the need of that property right now. I mean, and I think the sales have proved that, but I don't think we would be opposed to annexing certain pieces, but I would think for the city, it'd probably be more advantageous to bring in, if we're gonna come in with a master plan for that whole 320, which is our full intent, at least you've got a vision of what we're going to be doing also with it. And I think in my particular piece, that's what we did, and we tweaked it very little. I mean, very little. We used a lot of your suggestions with the zoning, which, you know, worked out great. And so I think it was just a great move to do that all at one time myself. But
Ed, what's your take on this? Put you on the spot as our city planner and looking at this development is in one of our three scenarios, but not in all three, and annexing the whole thing versus doing it in phases.
I think the difficulty you have as a commission is to, you know, we're looking at the growth area for a 20-year period, and you're trying to look at it, you know, and we've allocated well more than what we felt that we need, you know, based upon those last scenarios. Instead of choosing one of the three options, we chose in essence, all of them. We combined all of them together and made a gross scenario. So we further added well more units or allocation for residential, commercial, and industrial. Based upon that, you know, KLJ is going through the process now of factoring in the total cost for the infrastructure in order for us to accommodate development. There's only so much the development community can do. There has to be a collaborative effort with the city as well, you know, because we're going to either accept them or their lines have to lead to our lines in order to make the whole thing work. We haven't got that data. And I don't know if that data would change anything that Mr. Cook and the Haroff property would have, but that's an argument in silence at this point. I don't have definitive data to do it. To say that, yes, we have a lift station and we have some accommodation, well, that accommodation may be for this development may defer another development further down there because that allocation would be used up prematurely. So to answer your question, I don't think we have all the data together. That's why we're doing our comprehensive plan, to get all those numbers together for you to decide ultimately as a commission, do you feel comfortable with $300-400 million worth of infrastructure in order to accommodate development over the next 10 plus years? And if you as a commission decide that that is too much, you have sticker shock with respect to that, then you would naturally constrict some of the areas that you would have. I don't know if that would impact a portion of the Haroff property. I think the westernmost piece is probably the one in question. The western half is probably the one in question of how that infrastructure comes about and what is the best course. You know, we could always design or accept things from each developer, but if you don't look at your overall infrastructure holistically, well, we're accepting a piece here and a piece there and a piece there, and we find out later that, yes, it works. But if we would have holistically looked at the infrastructure, we could have saved money long-term-wise. Instead of having several lift stations, you may have been able to gravity feed it if you would have done it a different design. So, you know, based upon that, you know, we're looking, this is a 20-year projection that we're doing. I understand that the cost of land is expensive and no one would like to sit on land for an extended period of time, but we're only a couple of months away. You know, in many ways that I feel that, you know, to be fair with this one and the other annexations that are just, that are lagging behind, that probably we should look at them all holistically and wait until our comp plan's done. I think that's a fair way of looking at it. We will have a plan in front of us. We'll have cost. We'll know where the infrastructure issues are and how do we want to fund those. And based upon that, we can have good discussions with each developer and say, now we know exactly what we need. Okay, now you should do a cost share with respect to this because it's off-site. So as staff, it would help us out, I feel, and negotiating and looking at it as well.
Okay. Well, and like you said, Mr. Jackson, we're not making any decisions tonight. We just want kind of all the information out there to soak in, right?
Well, that's right. And you know, I was hoping we wouldn't get into the merits of the project tonight. I suppose some of that's unavoidable. I do need to say this. You know, I think by and large you've done a good job with Meadow Hills, and most importantly is you've done something. You've followed through and made it into a real subdivision, and that's what we need. We have too many that aren't happening in that regard. On the other hand, since you were here with Meadow Hills, we've annexed probably 1,000 acres of ground in the city. So the things are very different, and they're changing monthly, as you know, and all the rest of us know. Do you have anything else that you want to?
Well, we just hope that we can get this thing pushed and moved on to the next level. Obviously, timing again, and I can sympathize with what Mr. Cortante has to say, but I think we've taken our due diligence and time to look at this. We know where the future city sewers are going to be coming from. We know we can service our piece. We know we're ready, but timing in a lot of these developments is a big issue, and if you're talking two more months or three more months, that pushes all the designs, all the work back that much further. So when it comes time in the spring to bid these projects and start them, and again, I think Cook Metal Hills 4th is a good example. That took the whole building season, and it's been a real push to even get that completed to when we did. And if you're going to push that back 3 or 4 months, you may not see a lot of these parcels even be ready or have real estate ready for another year and a half to 2 years. And I guess we're just saying we're ready, we're there, we know the precautions, and we know what the expenses are, and we just have a great team that's willing to push this thing forward and see what we can do for the city.
It's a tough balancing act that we have, knowing that we need so many more homes today and apartments today and everything else, but making sure that our long-term decisions don't overdo things. And that's where we are. That's where the discussion is tonight. But I think that what we need to do tonight is give Mr. Cretan some direction. Do we want to entertain the formal request, ask our city attorney to prepare a resolution for some kind of annexation, some degree of annexation for our next meeting, which I think is actually 3 weeks from now?
Can I ask Chief Dossinger one question before we do anything? Since I'm out on the road a lot, I need some assistance here. How, if we're short of police officers, how are we going to handle all these annexations? I don't want to put you on the spot, but I am.
Well, I don't think there's a magical answer for that. As you know, we do have staffing needs with the increase of the growth of our city. Even though those areas aren't built out right away, we still do own that, both for fire and for police response. And that can be challenging.
So, in other words, we almost need, and the same with our fire department. I guess if everybody, we need your input too before we approve some more of these things to make sure we have coverage for all this.
Commissioner Dukart, I'm glad you asked that question, because there's no doubt that as these annexations do get built out and they go vertical, there's a demand on almost all city staff, not just fire department, not just police department, emergency services. Our assessing department, our accounting department, every department is impacted. So there definitely will be and need to be city staff members that will be requested to be added as these build out over the course of time.
And not only the staffing, it also increases the miles we put on our patrol vehicles, number of the size of our fleet, the number of snow removal pieces of equipment that you're going to need, it affects a lot.
And we don't want staff quitting because they're overworked. I don't want to hear that again.
Well, okay. This is all part of
the
broad conversation that we have to have. I think we all recognize that there'll be some day that we're saying no to annexations. Someday. I don't know if that's now or not.
Look, Commissioner Jackson, you stated earlier that you thought you wanted a full board at this meeting to make a decision, which obviously is Mayor Johnson. Why can't we, we're 3 weeks out from the next meeting, why can't we go ahead and hear the annex petition at the next meeting? And if there's anything we need to discuss at that meeting, I'm sure we can postpone.
Yeah. It's not a slam dunk just because it comes up before the commission at the next meeting. There's still going to be all of these questions and concerns, and the fact that it isn't in all three scenarios, you know, all of that is going to be brought up.
I agree.
We would be 3 weeks ahead on the petition, you know, and they would be down the road also. We can still
may not happen.
We can do that. We can have the resolution before us 3 weeks from now. I get the feeling Mr. Catan probably would like to see it rest a little longer than that. And we can make that decision as well.
With 3 weeks, 4 weeks, what would you feel comfortable with?
Well, Commissioner Steiner, I mean, I voiced my concern. And, you know, if you want to hear it 3 weeks or 4 weeks, I guess it really doesn't matter, you know, with respect to that. So that's you as a, you know, you as a commission to decide which way you want to go. I think, you know, as staff's perspective, if a development's a valid project, it will be there 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, whatever. Every community I've ever planned in, and I know we have an anomaly here where we have tremendous development and everything's pushing forward, and there's a development window of 10 to 15 years. But still, I mean, a couple months here or there is not going to adversely impact it. And if it adversely impacted, I think you'd have to draw up a flag and go, why would that be the case? If 3 or 4 months causes the whole development to fall apart, then I think you can draw a conclusion as probably a speculative venture to start off with. I mean, any valid one, a delay of that nature is not going to adversely impact it, that I see. If you're talking long-term wise, with respect to that, you know, I guess the question is, how much information as a commission did you want to feel comfortable with moving forth with annexations? An annexation is a boundary. It's not an entitlement. There's no guarantee that they'll get a rezone, that they'll get a preliminary plat and a subsequent final plat for that. So that's still left up to you know, decision down the road. But the question is, you know, as was brought up with Chief Dossinger, is, you know, there are impacts. We take on more land than there is a level of service standard that we haven't got to that point yet. That'll be hopefully part of our comprehensive plan, in which we look at fire service, police, emergency, and solid waste. You know, what are our expectations for that? And if you take on more land and you're stretching your resources, well, there's ways to accommodate that. You know, as a commission, you could look at that and go, okay, we're going to do that. Then if we annex a significant portion, then that means another police officer, another firefighter, another trash truck. I mean, all those things that those factor in, that's a budget amendment. You haven't factored that in. So those are issues I think are very warranted issues for you to consider and say, you know, if we're looking at an annexation and extending our boundaries, well, maybe we should look at what does that represent just staff-wise, and are you willing to make a budget amendment in order to accommodate that? Otherwise, the natural thing would be your level of service standards would go down. So we haven't had those discussions. I think those are very valid ones to have. You know, and unfortunately, as staff is as busy as we are, it's not as if we could sit back and go, okay, these are the impacts, and really get you a detailed one without some kind of time period in order for us to accommodate a schedule like that. So I don't know if that answers your question, Commissioner.
No, it does.
I think I could. Can I step in again? You listen to wanting to continuously halt, and it just to me it I'm sorry, it just doesn't make a whole lot of sense. I guess what we'd like to present is, we'd like your idea. Let's try to let this move on. You can always put the slam dunk to it, but we could still at least have some time, and by that time, to put this thing to use if it continues. I think we've got a good staff of people that we would be more than willing to help in any fashion with any kind of answering, question asking. I think we can make somebody, we will make somebody available at all times to help put these things together. And again, I think we've worked with the city over the years, and hopefully we did a great job. We brought in every answer to any question you've ever asked for the last 2.5 years, and I think we're ready to do that, and probably in a better stance this time, but we would just at least like to see this thing continue to the next level. You always have that authority to stop it, and I guess, again, we would sure like to see this continue on.
again, just so everybody hears it, I want to repeat, we already have ground annexed that will accommodate 15,000 people. We know that all won't be developed. We know that. My sense is that we should go ahead and make an up or down decision whenever the developer wants to come in with this formal request. You should know that it may behoove you to wait until this comprehensive plan is done. That may give us different information that may make us more likely to approve this annexation. And maybe not. Maybe we'll approve it anyway.
Well, I think, again, if there's anything you would want from the team we have assembled on this, we'd be more than happy to take those calls. We'll leave any numbers. We'll help you make the best rational decision there is. And I think we've done quite a bit of that with the sewer and the water portions of it. We can't make the decisions on the policing and the firing, but that's got to be expected to normal growth. You if you're going to add, you're going to have to add here, you're going to have to add there. I'm assuming any city has to go through that, but I think we would be more than willing to get any department whatever answers they would like, or any research that you would like from us. We'd be more than happy to get that for you, as long as we can kind of keep this thing moving on. And the time thing that Mr. Cortant is talking about, in an essence, no, it's not really going to hurt, but if you're looking to bring develop property, not just the next property, into the city, we're ready to do that. And the more we wait right now, trust me, I went through this year. We are losing out on how much can get completed in the construction season next year. It just keeps pushing all of that back, and we struggled and we pushed pretty hard to get completed what we did this year. So in essence, it's not going to be the end of the world, but it sure will not let you bring in what we're willing to bring in of actual developed property, not just the next property.
We need to give Mr. Cortant some direction.
I feel that we need to wait for full commission. I definitely would like Mayor Johnson here.
I think the direction we give is either 3 weeks the next meeting or 5 weeks at the second meeting.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'll leave it at that. I think the message is we're willing to entertain the annexation request, whether that's next meeting or the meeting after.
They've already submitted it. All we need is just a definitive legal boundary, legal description, and if they provide that, then we could put it on the agenda, have a resolution ready for that.
Okay.
That for you.
Anything else? Thanks, Mr.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Okay, our only remaining agenda item is the code enforcement report for September.
Thank you, Commissioner Jackson. From this point on, I'd like to change that. Actually, I'm not sure how the code enforcement report came in. I think it maybe times past it included more than just the development activity. I'd like to change that to building development report. I think it's probably more representative of what we're trying to convey instead of code enforcement, which is more violations and so forth. So just wanted to give you a heads up that we'll be changing that. Under new building permits, I mean, I feel like I'm a broken record. You're all aware of the, you know, we're continually increasing it. Every month is a record month with respect to the prior year. This year, what we will ultimately be like, I can't tell, but you know, at this point, we could very easily get up to 1,500 permits, maybe even more, because we have many, many apartments that are in the queue, and that would significantly increase it. When they come in at 200 or 300 at a time for that. So, but at this point, the commercial structures to date, we're at 50. Last year, the total was 41. So we're well ahead of that, and obviously the last 2 years have been record years. Single-family structures, I think, is one of the things that Commissioner Dukart had mentioned, we are significantly increasing the volume and the numbers that we do have. As of date of the end of September, we're at 481. The total that we had last year was 137, so we're at a 350% increase, and that's only through the month of September. And I've been told that in October and also November, our commercial ones are going to skyrocket. We've approved a bunch of them, so those numbers are going to escalate as well. So, you know, the total numbers, 598 compared to 255, 234% increase. The building permit values at 214 million compared to the total for all 12 months of last year at 123 million, 170% increase. And we're still doing that with essentially one staff member less. I mean, I've been very thankful for your support on allowing us to have Grand Forks to help us out. That is a tremendous benefit to our staff. But in the total numbers, we have overall dwelling units 896. That's a 50% increase from the total that we had last year. So we're continuing on. We're doing our very best. You know, we've changed our processes. We've increased the activity or the access to our permits and information on the internet. We've changed some of our hours and processing things in order to, in essence, work smarter instead of, you know, necessarily harder. At this point, we're working as hard as we can be, and we've got to figure out ways to prioritize how we do things. So I hope that we have your support with that. And we do have new ideas that we'll be working on in the next couple of months as well. So,
Mr. Cretan, thank you for the report. There was an article in the paper this week, I believe, that said Williston was at about 900 total permits for this year, 950 maybe it was, or something like that. We're at 600. Is that an apples-to-apples comparison, do you know?
No, I don't believe that is. I mean, if you add it in, and they may do the same thing that we have done, when you look at 600, then you go down to the very bottom where they have total dwelling units. Depends on how you break them up. I mean, each jurisdiction does them differently. If we have a apartment, a 30-unit apartment, we'll make that as one building permit. But in actuality, it's 30. So I'd look at our figures at roughly 900 as being pretty equivalent to what they're doing, and I think that's probably true. They may also, and I believe they do, include their mobile home permits. We do not do that with respect to first-time home buyer, not first-time, but the setups that you have maybe in a mobile home park and the rest. So, you know, it's not apples and apples. It's a variation that you have. I think it's indicative that both of our jurisdictions are at an incredible rate. And we're doing the very best we can to deal with that.
Okay, anything else, Mr. Cretan? Anything else, Ed?
No, thank you for the opportunity.
Okay, any city commissioners have anything they'd like to bring up? If not, anybody from the public? Anybody from the public has an issue they'd like to discuss? Or make us aware of? Seeing none,